In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Take heart in the face of suffering. You are God's precious son or daughter, and he will put things right for you. I'm filming here from, this is Dover Beach, and the reason that I'm filming from here this morning is because this is a place of real sorrow for me. These rocks here are my sorrow rocks. Just over a year ago, my marriage broke up, and it took around about 10 months or so to do so. It was a very harrowing time in which I tried desperately to put the marriage back together again. These were the rocks that I came to whenever I was really, really upset and despairing. And here I cried. I cried out to God, and here I waited several times to see if, when I went back, my wife would have left me or not. And in the end, she did. And this had a really big effect on me and my spirituality. I felt for a while completely unable to pray or to minister. I felt sort of taken out. The reason I'm telling you this is because it's a common experience that suffering impacts our spirituality, impacts our spiritual drive, and impacts the ministry for God that we might have. The experience of suffering, and especially the experience of suffering at the hands of someone else, can literally demoralize us. It can undermine our sense of moral values, our priorities, the things that we give ourselves to. And particularly, it can undermine our sense of standing in God and of God's presence and of love. Now, the scriptures today say to us that God knows this, and that he acknowledges that suffering is a really terrible experience, and that it can undermine our sense of commitment to God and the worth of following God. It can do that. And it says to us, stay steady. Stay steady in the face of suffering. Because, and there's a reason for this, because you are God's precious son or daughter, and he will put things right for you. The Isaiah passage, Isaiah, speaks of God as the greatest. And he is the one who has always been there. He sees what's been, but he also knows what's coming. And he says, there is no other rock. There's no rock like our God, stronger than these rocks. In the gospel passage, what Jesus is saying is this. He's saying basically, take heart. Yes, there is evil in the world. There is harm in the world. But this is not a mistake. This is not a sign that God is not absent and he doesn't know and he won't put things right. He's leading it this way for a reason, for a while. And we have to bear with that. But take heart. Stay steady. And then in the Romans passage, Paul particularly talks about God being our father, our daddy. The word Abba is the Aramaic word for daddy. If you go to the Middle East today, you can buy a souvenir mug with Abba on it. You take it home and give it to your dad. It says dad. And this is a completely new relationship which Jesus gave us to understand that God is our daddy. And that we are his precious children, his precious sons and daughters, and that he will put things right. And Paul particularly talks about suffering as participating in the sufferings of Jesus, that we are not alone in our suffering, that Jesus understands our suffering because he has suffered more mentally and spiritually than anyone. And when I come here, I remember that suffering, but I also remember that in the intervening year that there's been many, many signs of God's presence to me and God's encouragement to me. I still struggle every day with thoughts about what happened and am pulled towards bitterness and anger and despair. And every day there's a struggle not to do that. But this is the point. There is the struggle. I do struggle and I do win. And I don't know what your suffering has been. Your suffering will be as great as my suffering. It will have been different to mine, but the effect of it will be the same on you. Whatever suffering that you have experienced in a different kind of way, or maybe in a similar way to me, I want us to say this, that the word of God is true and God's presence is real, and that the passages today that we have are worth meditating on, because he says to us, take heart in the face of suffering. I am your father, your daddy. You are my precious son or daughter, and I will put things right for you. Now, for some people, of course, the whole image of God being a father, a daddy, is not a good one, because their particular suffering has been that of abuse by a father or by father figures in their life. In which case, I just want to say to you, change the image if that's true for you. Change the image perhaps to that of a mother or whoever was the strong parent figure in your life that actually did something for you. It could have been a social worker, or it could have been another family member. It could have been somebody completely out of the family. But the point is that all of us, even when we've experienced abuse, can understand what it is like, or what it might be like, to receive the love of a true and reliable parent figure. And this is what God is for us. I don't know if you've read the novel The Shack or seen the film that's based on it. It had a profound effect on me. It is effectively like a really, really, really long parable. It has a similar impact to the parables of Jesus, an unusual ways of looking at spiritual life and the sufferings of life. I don't want to give too much of a spoiler in case you want to read it or see it, but our hero, the person whose story is told, does have and has had an abusive relationship with his father. And so when God appears to this man, God appears not as a father but as a woman, as a black woman, as it happens. And it's just such an amazingly wonderful character that she is, just imbuing all the values of the gospel. It is profoundly, profoundly good, because it looks at old truths in a new way and makes them really real.
Press out, fold back, rotate. All there is to it. I know what a great gulf there is between us, Mac. You may not believe it, but I am especially fond of you. That's grown inside you and between us. There's no easy answer that'll take your pain away. No instant fix that's enduring. Life takes a bit of time and a lot of relationship.
Mm-hmm. You're the Almighty God, right? You know everything. You're everywhere all at once. You have limitless. us bow. Yet somehow, he let my little girl die. When she needed you most, you abandoned her.
I never left her.
If you are who you say you are, where were you when I needed you?
Son, when all you see is your pain, you lose sight of me.
Stop talking in riddles. How can you say that you will help me when you couldn't help her? Because of you, she's gone. Unless you can change that, I will never be free.
The truth sets everyone free, Mackenzie. And the truth has a name. He's over in his woodshed right now, covered in sawdust.
Truth? I know that story. You left him, too. Seems like you have a bad habit of turning your back on those you supposedly love.
I'm not who you think I am.
He said it himself. My God, why hast thou forsaken me?
No, Mac. You misunderstand the mystery. What my son chose to do didn't cost us both dearly. Love always leaves a mark. We were there together. I never left him. I never left you. I never left Miss.
And so whatever it is that you're facing at the moment, whatever suffering you may be experiencing, or whatever flashbacks that you get from past suffering, whatever triggers there are, like these rocks trigger for me, that suffering, whatever it is, the message of the readings today is still the same. Don't despair. Don't give in to that kind of vortex of despair and hopelessness that leads us to something which the ancient monastics called acedia. It's a sort of spiritual listlessness where we stop bothering, we stop trying, because hey, what's the point? The world is a dark place, people are evil, suffering happens, even my own self is not great, there's no point anymore, and we give up. And Jesus is saying, look, don't. Take heart, don't go that way. Take heart, understand that this is for a time, that you have been planted by your Heavenly Father in this world for a purpose, and continue to grow and be fruitful and fulfill that purpose. In last week's Gospel readings, the seed was the Word of God. In this week's Gospel reading, the seed is people. And it's saying that you have been planted as a seed in this world, and God is nurturing you. You will grow, you will be fruitful. Don't worry about the weeds that are there. One of the problems with this gospel reading, when you come to it, is that it does look terribly black and white. Jesus seems to be saying in the gospel, there are children of the devil and there are children of my Father, and you're either one or the other. Jesus does seem to do this a fair bit. There are times when he does divide people into two categories, the sheep and the goats is another parable. And he also says that if you are not for me, then you are against me. Mind you, he also says if you're not against me, then you are for me. Now, what's going on here? I don't want us to misunderstand what Jesus is saying. He is not explaining as a philosopher his ontology of the world, the being that we are. He's not saying this is how human beings are in their psychology. He's just describing a particular aspect of the kingdom of God. This is a parable of the kingdom. Now, it's true, isn't it, when we look at ontology, when we look at being, when we look at how we are as people, we are all shot through with good and bad. We have the propensity for great, great good, and we also have the propensity for great, great evil. And most of us have done both. And so when we look at our own lives and we look at some of the things that we have done, the way that we have treated people, the hurt that we have done in the world, we might think, well, I have been an instrument of the enemy also for the damage of others. What does that make me? Am I one of those weeds that are planted by the evil one? And yet we also can see the action of God's grace in our lives and the way that he's worked through us to bless others. What are we to make of this reality, of this, these shades of grey that we are with the black and white of the gospel? Well, Jesus is just saying this, really, that when you look at the world from the point of view of the kingdom of God, then what you're looking for, and what Jesus is looking for, is where are the values of the kingdom? Where are the fruits of the Holy Spirit? Where are the people who are promoting Christ's way, Jesus' way, God's way? Who are the ones that are not just preaching the word of God, preaching the values of the kingdom, but embodying the values of the kingdom? Which individuals are doing that? Which families are doing that? Which communities of people are embodying the kingdom values? And what he's saying is that if you look from the point of view of the kingdom of God, that society, the world, in any particular place and time, there are those who are carrying forward the program of the kingdom of God, and there are those who, by their actions, deeds, or attitudes and words, are undermining the values of the kingdom. And that it's this that you can see as being people being agents of the Father or agents of the enemy. It's all about the values of the kingdom. And I guess, insofar as we have in our lives undermined the values of God's kingdom by our actions or our deeds or our words, then maybe we have been instruments of the enemy. But that's not who we are in our being and ourselves. In our being and ourselves, we are the children of God, his precious sons and daughters. And so there is always the capacity in us to turn from that. And that's what the whole business of repentance is all about. Jesus did preach. He said, repent, for the kingdom of God is near. You can enter the kingdom whenever you wish by choosing to repent and responding to his message. And so that's part of what we do every day. The ancient monastics understood that repentance was not a one-time thing like some evangelical preachers seem to want to portray. It's a daily changing, a daily turning back to the ways of God again, back to the values of the kingdom. I think that the numbers of people that I've met who are truly evil are very, very few. But I have met people whose own motivation and values are so destructive to others and even ultimately to themselves, although they may seem selfish in a way, but destructive to themselves also, so destructive that they are truly evil. And there are people also who have been so hurt that they compensate by giving themselves over to the destruction of others' hearts, minds and morals and values and bodies even. And that this, there is this evil in the world, there is no doubt about it. But what we are called to do is to turn away from them, to pray for those who embody those values, to speak and act and live as well as we can in the power of God's Spirit and in the presence of his love for the values of the kingdom, and to counter the undermining of those values and of evil wherever we see it and wherever we have the capacity to act. We all might have that in different kinds of ways. But ultimately, the message of this gospel is not an analysis. The message of this gospel reading and of the other readings today is an encouragement. It's to say, look, don't be discouraged. Don't give up. There will always be the presence of those who are undermining the very, very things that you stand for and will do you harm if they can. They will not be for your good. But don't lose heart. Continue to stay rooted in Christ. Continue to grow and be fruitful. And understand that you're not the only piece of wheat in the field. There's a whole lot of others there with you as well. All who are rooted in the same God and who have the same love of Christ in their hearts, who are growing and being fruitful in their own ways. As a community, we embody God's presence and God's love. This is the message then for today. Stay steady in the face of suffering. Remember and understand that you are God's precious son or daughter, and that he will act for your good. He will put things right. Amen.